Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm John Solberg, head of communications for FX Networks. And on behalf of everyone at FX and our studio partners, FX Productions and Fox Television Studios, I want to thank you all for coming out to tonight's screening and panel for our critically acclaimed hit drama series, The Americans. Tonight we have a special treat. You will be the first to see the season one finale of The Americans tonight. And I want to thank our executive producers, Joe Weisberg and Joel Fields and their crews and staff, everybody for making this possible. We ask that since it doesn't air until next Wednesday, please don't divulge any details publicly on any websites. Please don't take any photos or video of the screen tonight. And we will have a great panel afterwards. So it is my honor to introduce the season one finale of The Americans. We present The Colonel. Again, thank you all for coming. I hope you enjoyed that. And now it's time for our panel. Our moderator is the esteemed TV critic and columnist for the Huffington Post, Maureen Ryan. Prior to the Huffington Post, Maureen spent about a decade as the lead TV critic for the Chicago Tribune. And she has been a longstanding member of the Television Critics Association. She's also served as a juror for many years on the AFI and Peabody Awards Committee. And earlier this month, Complex Media ranked her number one in their list of the 25 best TV bloggers in America. And of Maureen, they said, "There is no one talking about television who's as enjoyable to read or listen to as Maureen Ryan. Ryan offers incredibly thoughtful cultural commentary, and few critics have as deep an understanding of the state of television as Ryan. Though her cerebral arguments impress, her heart makes her work irresistible. Anyone who devotes their life to sitting in front of that blue glow must love TV, but few critics find a way to channel the joy they experience as a viewer into their criticism as fully as Mo Ryan. It's that combination of intellectual firepower and fandom intensity that make her the most entertaining television critic working today." Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce our moderator. Please welcome Maureen Ryan.
I did mention to John that you can't ever believe anything you read on the internet, so very excited to be part of this event. The Americans take something that we thought we knew and puts it in a whole new light. We know the broad outlines of the Cold War, but what about the warriors whose battles were never recognized? What about the men and the women on the front lines who sacrificed so much for their countries? As we saw in the show's exciting finale, Philip and Elizabeth have given everything to Mother Russia, but they can't bring themselves to sacrifice their children. They can't sacrifice their marriage, which started out as a cover, but has become so much more. Compelling art forces us to ask the big questions. What's real? What's love? What's loyalty? What's worth killing and dying for? And then there's the biggest question of them all. How do they get the Wigs to stay on? To answer those questions and many more, we've got the cast and executive producers of The Americans. Please give a big hand to Annette Mahendru, who plays Nina. Margot Martindale, who plays Claudia. Noah Emmerich, who plays Agent Stan Beeman. Matthew Rhys, who plays Philip Jennings. Joel Fields, executive producer of The Americans. And Joe Weisberg, creator and executive producer of The Americans. Obviously, there's one very important person who is not here. Carrie Russell very, very much wanted to be here, but she could not get away from her movie. She was very heartbroken that she couldn't be here, but she did film a special message, so let's take a look at that.
Hi, everyone. I'm so sorry I can't be there with you tonight. I am up here in the Canadian wilds shooting Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, which is basically the same story as the Americans, just with a lot less eyeliner and high-waisted jeans. No, but seriously, I so wish I could be there with you tonight, and I hope the evening is going very well, and I hope you guys are all answering questions and making us seem very intelligent and interesting. If there are any questions for me, just direct them to the Welshman. Have a great evening, and I'm thinking of you, and I will see you all very soon.
Bless you.
So I want to start actually with the last scene that we saw, which is Paige going into the laundry room. And, you know, what was the thought process on how you ended the season? Did you want to leave it ambiguous? Can you take me through how you wanted to wrap things up and sort of set up the next year?
Well, I mean, we've been thinking all along about the kids of these parents and what their lives are like and what kind of things through their whole childhoods have been going on as they watch this guy and his wife go on and leave the house and have these crazy rules about who can and who can't go in the bedroom and what kind of things have been percolating. And it just seemed like a good time for Paige to finally have some of it percolate up and for her to start to wonder. And I don't think she's, of course, at the point of wondering or starting to think my parents are spies, but just at the point of starting to think,
why is there so much washing? So much knitwear.
Exactly.
It's all hand wash.
But there is, for everyone, at some point in adolescence, you start to suspect that your parents aren't exactly who you thought they were. And of course, in Paige and Henry's case, there's
once
something
to it. Once she finds
the
wigs, it's all over. There's a giant case of wigs in the garage, I have a feeling, right? There's so many. How about Matthew? Many, many people on Twitter wanted me to ask about the wig, the advanced Soviet wig technology.
Yes.
Clearly they are winning that race.
Yeah, yes. We have a little too much fun with the wig work. Those characters we're playing, various disguises have now become, they take on their own personas in the makeup trailer. And there's a sort of wig wall that, everyone who has to dress as a 1970s porn star or something similar has their picture put up, and we give them backstories and character names. So there's a lot of fun to be had by that.
Are you a little jealous, Noah, that you did not get in on that sweet wig action this season?
I'm wearing one now.
It's really amazing, I gotta say. It looks great.
It seems to have slipped onto your chin.
No, I am a little jealous. I mean, it does seem like a lot of fun. I'm hoping for season two, Stan gets
a wig.
A wig for Christmas.
Yeah. Stan's son finds a box of wigs in Stan's wardrobe. Like, entirely new story.
Those Jennings are slightly kinky.
Yeah.
There's so many places you can go with just mustaches alone. I think.
Different clubs, you mean.
I think if there's one thing that we learned about the Americans this season, it's that they like to see people like to see Carrie Russell beat people up. And I wanted to ask Margot what it was like to film that gigantic beatdown where in the cold, drafty warehouse she was expressed her her negativity towards you.
Well, it was very, very, very cold. And I did almost none of that.
I think you made the right choice.
So I did stick the top of my head in the water, and I did sort of fall backwards, and somebody else did the rest. She was really good.
Let's hear it for the stunt team on the Americans, right? Yes. They're pretty incredible. But as the season progressed, actually, the scenes between Claudia and Elizabeth were just especially crackling with energy. I mean, are you hoping to come back for season two to engage in more of that?
I certainly am.
Angry. What do you think?
I'm still alive. That's the good part.
Yay! Unlike, well, I'm not going to say, there are other shows that did not extend you that courtesy, but we won't go into that. What do you think her issue is with Philip and Elizabeth? Is it she just views them as, you know, disobedient children, just generational differences? She just doesn't like them as people? How do you view it in your mind when you...
I think I really like her. What? I think I see her as myself.
Really?
Him, I'm not so sure.
I always thought it was a love triangle. And that's where the conflict came from. Well, that's what I've been playing.
Well, Stan is in the middle of a very, very complicated love triangle right now. I mean, Nina...
Tell them about it.
He's got two lovely ladies.
It's a good year for Stan.
It's only going to get more complicated, it seems like.
I'm very jealous of Stan.
For a government employee...
Doesn't know yet.
Well, Annette, do you think that Nina ever had feelings for, has ever had any positive feelings for Stan, or is it all just about surviving the situation she's in?
Nina has, it's gonna be something really good, but she has a lot of feelings for Stan. He's an American man, and he's her only friend, and he's her hero, and she hopes he'll continue to be her hero.
But now that she knows that he killed Vlad, or she's
right.
Figured that out, that's got to change the dynamic for her a little bit, don't you think?
Of course, yes. But he has to do certain things, and so does Nina. So
yeah.
I think there's understanding there, and it helps Nina now that she's been promoted.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that there's something really bad now going on, I have something on him now.
We're all of you turning the pages of the finale script, like, what's going to happen to my character? Except you. You're probably going to live. But was it very pinned?
She doesn't make it.
No.
Next year it's called The American.
I like it.
Septicemia, apparently. Yeah, she's gone to play with a different set of monkeys.
And then he's the tragic widower. It's a whole different thing to play. But Clark, what's the deal?
I love Clark. I have a very soft spot in my heart for Clark.
He's a bad man. He's tricking poor Martha, right?
Yeah, he's torn about it, I think.
Do you think so?
No.
Well, Martha is wonderfully played. I just wonder, is he able to compartmentalize? We see him being tender with the family and so in love with Elizabeth, and yet he's able to, you know, hurt people, threaten people, kill people, and do this horrible thing to this innocent woman who just has no clue. Is he just really good at putting things in separate boxes in his mind, or is that, what is your conception of it?
Yes, it is. So to me, that was always the case, and that it kept the feelings that he had for Elizabeth very true and pure. But yeah, I think there are elements at times where that conflict does creep in, and, you know, he does... You know, there's an emotional strain to him at times that doesn't make things as black and white or as clear cut as he'd like them to be. And I'm sure that, you know, in the recesses there's guilt about poor old Martha and her new wallpaper.
Well, at least she has the consolation of having had some lovely times with Clark.
I like to think so.
Seems that way. I don't know. Maybe if the actors just want to talk about how much for your characters do you think, how much are they motivated by ideology, how much by a personal agenda? Is it really the motherland, the Soviet Union, or is it America? Like, what, when you conceive of these characters and think about how you're building them and growing them, what do you think about? Is it more personal or more political?
I think for Stan, it's all political and ideological and noble. You know, I mean, I think of Stan as giving everything he has to his job at the great expense to his own personal life and sense of self. Even, I mean, we haven't explored. We've touched upon the backstory that we've alluded to, which we'll discover in the future the details of that. But I think. He sees himself as you know, giving himself to a higher calling, a noble cause, defending, you know, the country and the belief system and the society that he believes is worth defending, and sacrificing his own personal agenda in the name of a higher cause. So,
how about the ladies? Is it ideology or is it personal? With Claudia, she seems very motivated by just doing a good job.
I'm the best soldier I can be for my country.
This is what she tells us every day.
And I think I went to Stanislavski acting company.
In Moscow.
Oh, that was Moscow. You. That was one of my, that's one of my things I was picked for. No, I don't. I think that you know, she'll do anything for the motherland, and I think probably a very lonely person.
How about Nina?
We're all lonely, aren't we?
We're all lonely. Sad. We're sad.
Nina's learning a lot through experience. And she's been promoted, and through Stan, she's learning a lot through Stan, which is really interesting, which makes the relationship really complicated. But Russia!
And you're the only actual native Russian speaker in the cast, so is it? Do you feel like you have one up on in terms of just understanding the context of this show? Does it give you special insight?
It does, but Lev is also Russian. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of Russian actors. I grew up around it, so it's.
So is it less? Is it kind of fun for you to go visit that era of your country's history?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yes, it's very rewarding.
And you know, Russia in the time frame of the show is heading toward some very serious turmoil and political unrest. You know, there's. Brezhnev dies in 82, and we're in 81 now. So do you foresee taking a time jump, or like, is it just going to be a few weeks after the finale, or how are you conceiving of that? Tell us all the spoilers now.
Well, I think because of where this episode ended, we're probably going to want to pick up pretty soon afterwards and show what happened, whether or not there will be an American or some Americans. But you're right that the events in the Soviet Union are going to start playing an important role. The Brezhnev dies not too long in the future, and then the next two leaders after him die pretty soon after that. And it's really only a few years after that that the whole thing starts to fall apart to a certain degree. So the historical events are going to start to catch up with us very soon.
Mm-hmm. It's fun, you know, one of the premises of the show is that Philip is more attuned to the American way of life than perhaps Elizabeth, and likes America. Do you ever sit there and think about what does he think is in his future, sort of just melting back into the American fabric, or does he think he'll have to go back to Russia at some point? Would he actually do that?
From a purely personal point of view, when I first approached Philip, especially in the pilot, when defection is raised in the laundry room for the first time, I the way I viewed it is that he sees that it's possibly not a sustainable life, that there's a very real risk that the net is closing in on them, and they have two children, and what would happen if they were to be caught? And I think honestly the only real way of guaranteeing security for the children would be defection, therefore, you know, guaranteeing that they would be taken care of by the government. So I think it's this sort of super objective in life is to make sure his children have a safe future, ultimately. And he loves Mustangs and hamburgers.
And cowboy boots, right? Didn't he buy some boots in the pilot?
Of course.
The fashion sense on this guy is just ridiculous. I mean, this is the only show where the cast has never wanted to take the wardrobe home. They're not.
It's true. There's a couple of moments, like on a Friday night, you know, and you run late, and you run into the wardrobe train, and you go, no, you're all right.
But if they ever do like a themed, if you want to go to a themed disco night, like an 80s
night,
you're all set.
We'd clean up.
Exactly. Well, speaking of the show and the production details of it, there are some really amazing fight scenes in this show. Some of them do appear to be you as opposed to the stunt team. Do you come home black and blue, or what? Or is that just from the EPs beating up on you?
Usually.
It's actually Margot that does his
fight. Yes, Margot does mine, usually. Yeah. And my stunt double does the emotional scene.
He's doing great.
You know, yeah. He's very good.
He's coming along well.
Yeah. No, we were lucky. We've had a great stunt team. Right from the get-go, we were given a great deal of training. So we also have a modicum of fun doing them as well.
Is it kind of action hero time? Do you enjoy that aspect of the show, just like running around? The car chase in the finale was incredible, right?
He did all of that.
I did a lot of the driving.
All the driving,
really?
Not the skids I didn't do, but the sort of the weaving in the cars.
So had you always had like a childhood dream of being in Starsky and Hutch?
Absolutely. And it's this show in particular. So having grown up on American television, it was the cars that has really sort of struck a sort of nostalgic chord for me, because those were the cars in the shows that I grew up with, and then all of a sudden I'm allowed to put my foot down in one of them.
Nice.
It's a lot of fun.
Nice. In terms of season two, what do you foresee? I hope Richard Thomas can come, and the whole cast is so great. You know, do you foresee a lot of the regulars we saw that made it coming back into the fold, Martha and hopefully Richard,
We sure hope so, yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
We want Claudia back, obviously. We're all praying to the mother Russia. I don't know what they do over there. And going back to the Stan and Nina thing, just Noah, do you think that he has real feelings for Nina, or is it just confusion over the status of that whole situation?
I'm always wary of answering these questions that I think is fun for the audience to struggle with, and I actually, oddly enough, don't have the authoritative answer to that as much as these guys do.
Oh, come on, you're in love with her?
Well, you're talking personally or professionally. So, I really do think it's more interesting to leave that be. I mean, we have to make choices as actors how to play things,
sure.
And I certainly made my choices, but I think I'm always wary of answering the sort of more intriguing questions for the audience. And also, I'm probably the wrong guy to ask. Really, the writers who are have a better insight to that, oddly enough.
All right, well, let's put you on the spot.
I'm not answering after you said that. I would answer if you hadn't said that. But that.
What do you?
He just said we'd ruin it for him. No.
But do you? I want to go back to the situation with Amador, his partner. Mm. I think obviously the death of when he killed Vlad, that was a turning point for Nina, definitely, and certainly for Stan. Could he have done that? Could he have killed someone like that if his partner hadn't been murdered? Like, what was?
Well, I actually have a point of view on this that I will share. I don't think of Stan's killing of Vlad as emotional or personal, as contextually as it seems to be. I think it's, Stan calls up the Residentur and says, you have our man. If you don't give him back, I'm going to kill the man of yours that we have. Mm-hmm. And then the man, Amador, shows up dead. So Stan has sort of put himself into a corner at that point. If he doesn't follow through with the sort of, the deterrent threat that he made, it feels like Stan thinks that America will lose credibility as a dangerous entity that you don't mess with, or there will be retaliation. So I feel like, as emotional as Stan is in that moment, and as complicated as it is for him, I feel like it's a logical, political, strategic decision that he forces himself into. The phone call might have been a mistake when he calls up the resident Turin says, you know, if you don't give us back Amador. Of course, Stan's mistaken, but he doesn't know that. He's so resolute and confirmed in his belief that they took Amador. So I think once Amador shows up like that, he feels, I don't think he has any pleasure or joy in that action. I think he feels it's necessary.
It's not really a revenge thing for him?
My interpretation of Stan is no. It's not a revenge. It's political and strategic. Not that there's not, you know, like Nina says, it's not black and white. There may be some resonance of emotional revenge or not, but I don't think Stan is a man that would let his emotional state compromise his duty.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of that, I'm going to put you on the spot again, and if you don't want to answer, it's fine. But the whole one of the great things about the pilot was him, you know, Stan checking out the car and kind of thinking, what's going on, having some suspicions of his neighbors. Is that something that you hope to, that he's, but then the rest of the season he was more or less, we didn't see a lot more of that. Do you hope he just becomes friends with the Jennings? Do you hope he get to work on playing those suspicions again, or do you have not really thought about it either way?
Well, definitely one of the more interesting parts of the character and the role is all these different sort of relationships that he has, both personally, professionally, and the obfuscation between the two. So I think that cat and mouse suspicion that he has of the neighbors when he first encounters them is fun. It's sort of, it can get old very quickly. So I think very wisely the writers chose to backpedal on that a little bit, but it's still alive to some degree. And I think you have to be careful about hitting those notes too repetitively. Otherwise, it either gets boring for the audience or Stan seems really less intelligent than he is. He's certainly more intelligent than I am, but
you're playing him very intelligent.
But I think that's really fun, the mixing of the personal and the professional and not knowing where anybody really is. I mean, there's so many sort of layers of this onion of all the relationships between all the characters, what's authentic, what's not. Even in the marriage, even in the central marriage, there's questions of, is there love, is there not love, who loves who, is it, you know? So I think those are fun balls to be juggling, and I think it's entertaining, both for the actors, certainly, and for the audience, hopefully.
There should be a fishing trip, I think, season two.
We're Stan
Phil and Stan go fishing.
Yeah.
Guys' weekend.
Yeah.
Gone fishing.
What wig would you bring?
Try not to give away all of them.
Oh, sorry.
It's bowling night.
That sounds like fun. Speaking of more really memorable scenes, there was Claudia taking out the CIA guy. That was a purely revenge-driven act for her? That, you know, this was someone who meant a great deal to her and it couldn't, or was it could not stand because it was a crime against Russia?
Revenge.
Yeah.
Purely revenge. He was my lover.
And how,
maybe.
How was it working with a 1980s taser?
Well, it was really scary.
The barbs.
It really was.
Those barbs had a mind of their own.
I made them shoot that thing three times before I picked it up, because once it shoots, it's different. They disarmed the electricity, but it still had little bars that stick into you, and those bars were going to pop back on me, and I was worried they're going to hit my eyes and put my eyes out. Everybody else on that side of the camera had goggles on. So a few times I went, but I think it was okay when I finally did it.
It looked fine from our side. Well, just all these people have had to commit these terrible acts to, you know, kind of stay in the game, so to speak. Do you think Nina took that vow? Was that, like, from the heart for her?
Oh,
would she kill for Russia?
Of course I would.
No, we're talking about the show.
Oh! Him, I don't know.
So for the creators, the kids have been really important this season. Do you hope to kind of bring them more into the mix, even more so in season two, because, you know, their suspicions or just the interactions with the family life, is that, are those the kind of scenes that you like to write? Because there was so much going on with the submissions and the spy stuff that, you know, is it something you're hoping to delve into a great deal more in season two?
I think we definitely want to explore the family more and the family dynamic more. It seems to be the next thing to explore outside of the marriage.
Yeah.
That's maybe the next iteration of the personal stories.
I say Stan and Philip take the Cub Scouts on a camping trip. And there's maybe some kind of, I'm just pitching you.
It's good.
Yeah.
So I have the Red Brigade.
You make them all sing like, you know, Soviet songs and wear
good,
red scarves.
Good, yeah.
Is there, I think we were going to take some audience questions, right? Is that something that's happening? So let's, can we start that part of it? All right, so just we can't see you at all, so just go for it.
Okay.
Anyone's at the mic.
I wanted to know, how was the reception by doing...
Oh, okay.
Gotcha. Okay, over there.
Hi.
Oh, there he
is.
We're good spies.
Yes.
By doing such a daring idea, what has the reception been with the Capitol and with Russia?
Wow. Well, every script that Joe has his name on has to go to be reviewed by and approved by the CIA.
Ooh.
So I like to say the show is approved by the CIA. We have not yet heard from the KGB.
They will be sending you a message, it will be in your home, it will be, yeah. Actually, speaking of that, you have a background in this, you are a CIA officer. Have you heard from people that were working, did you research, obviously you researched the era to do the show, but as you've been making the show, have you gotten more consultations from people who were in the field at that time? Is that something that's become, like, have you got feedback from people who were kind of there, so to speak?
Well, I get a lot of, especially the last couple of months, I've gotten a lot of emails from quite a number of my old friends from the CIA who I lost contact with. And I'd say that about 90% of them are just, how have you been, getting back in touch, and it's great to hear from these people again, and they love the show. And
did any of them say, did you base Clark on me?
Anyway, there about 10% of them are people who, you know, go through scene by scene and complain about the tradecraft.
Really?
And, you know, we work very hard to make the tradecraft accurate. I think the tradecraft in the show is really good, but it's hard for various reasons to make it perfect. So they go through and they're like, Joe, you know you can't do the dead drop just like this, and what's the matter with you, and da, da, da. And then I incredibly enough, I write back, and I explain, well, there was a production problem here and a budget problem there, so we had the, and then they write back again. And they keep complaining, and then I kind of give up. So that's sort of that's how that goes.
And it's very good that they're not writing for the show, is I think what we're learning, that they're doing what they do. So do we have another question somewhere?
Okay, so each of you have to do dialects and accents. Some actors will stay in all day, some people will stay through lunch, some people will stay through the scene. Daniel Day-Lewis, still doing Lincoln, I think, but... But when you guys, the wackiest, serious show cast I've ever seen, but for when each of you do your dialects or voices, how long do you commit to the voice, all day, all week, all month, just for that line only?
For me, it's dependent on a few things. If I'm having trouble in a scene, pretending to be a Russian, pretending to be an American. if the accent is slipping, I'll try and stay in it a little while longer. If there's an emotional scene coming up, or if I'm tired, I'll tend to try and stay in and out, just top and tail the scene. But I find it hard to do it all day. I always feel a little bit fake if I'm doing it all day, and a little confused.
Yeah, I think this is fake.
It is fake. I'm from Indiana. I just.
Well, I think in an upcoming season, and playing some undercover role of a Welshman.
Yes.
Are you hoping for that at some point? You can just let it go.
I've tried that. Although there's the Jennings go on holiday to Wales or something. That would be good.
A group vacation.
Yeah.
Sounds lovely.
Yeah.
Swansea.
Yeah.
Question over here.
Hi, my name is Patricia. First of all, this show is so well cast, so well acted. But for Joe and Joel, when I first saw the coming attractions that it was coming, I thought, how come we never thought of this before? I mean, I lived through the Cold War as a kid. And I find myself cheering for the KGB. I don't want anything to understand. But really, I mean, it's just so well written. I mean, am I the only one that's cheering for the KGB?
I have your name, you, please.
Patricia Watt.
Copy, Patricia.
Anyway, thank you. It's really and everything. Thanks a lot. It's a great show. I'm really enjoying it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Director at S, thanks you.
Yeah.
Over here, another one?
My question is for Matthew. I want to know which scenes you prefer to play, the ones with Elizabeth that are emotional or all the spy, exciting, fighting stuff?
Carrie's not here, remember.
Yeah. I hate working with her. Yes. No, this is the beauty of this job, is that as a sort of box-ticking actor's ideal job, this really is it. You get to play out your boyhood fantasies and run around with guns and fast cars. It was the relationship at its core that I found incredibly unique and complex and attractive in the pilot. And It's the scenes with her I enjoy the most because they're the most challenging. I think this, trying to pitch where those two are at any one given moment is I find difficult, and in that challenge it's very enjoyable. But as a whole we're very lucky to do what we get to do in this.
Can I just follow up on that? And did I read somewhere that Carrie slaps you before scenes? Like, is that every time?
It's incredibly often.
It sounds painful.
It originated from, and Joel's testament to this, it originated from the one of the initial chemistry reads where Gavin O'Connor, director of Warrior, whispered, unbeknownst to me, to Kerry, we did the laundry scene where she does slap me, and he just said, slap him. Or I think he said, clock him. which is different to slap. Block seems to me to suggest a greater sense of violence. Anyway, so we're doing the scene, and I thought it was going rather well. I was off book and everything, and she wound up this slap that must have started the day before. Hit me so hard. And both Joe and Gavin went, you took that slap so well. And I went, because I didn't even know what state I was in. Anyway, it became this very funny, very, we took the slap so well, very funny, running joke. And now on set, she thinks it's hilarious. And it's usually in this very, very short moment, in between the first AD shouting, turn over, and when they go, and, before they say action, and she just goes, boom. I'm like.
When you're at her bedside,
yeah,
looking tenderly.
It. And sometimes the makeup artist goes, can you stop doing that? He has a red handprint on his hand.
Does she actually dislodge all your hair and your wigs and your mustache?
No, it's rare. I have wigs. She knocked a mustache off once.
This is a violent set. This is.
I know,
violent.
It's awful. Awful.
Terrible. I'm
Cold
so
Cold War
sad.
Was dangerous.
I know.
Just not just the fashion,
no,
but
I know.
The whole, every part of it. I think, where were we? Are we at this side now? This side? Okay, go for it. What's your question?
Hi, thank you all so much for coming out, by the way. Question about Clark. Is it an inside joke reference to Clark Kent and Superman, like with his hair and the glasses and secret identity, and then he takes off the glasses and becomes Philip? Is that an inside joke or just a coincidence?
I like to think so. I turned up with my underwear outside my towel for the Sunday. No one laughed. There was a couple of, there's a scene where I was in the phone booth as Clark just before I got lynched by that, and I did the whole spin. Oh, no laughs. But I've sort of let that one go.
I would say that is, I think that is such a good joke that I wish I had thought of it when I named that character, but I did not.
Don't you know that at this point you're supposed to say yes, that was
good. Oh, of course, yes.
I should. Absolutely.
In a couple of years, maybe I'll claim that.
Yeah, you'll backtrack a little bit. Do we have a question on this side? Anyone? One more on that side. Yeah.
Hi. My name is Dennis. I don't root for the KGB or the FBI. I root for the Jennings.
Ah.
And my question is, I was just wondering, how realistic is it something like a Russian spy marrying an unsuspecting American citizen? Did that kind of thing ever happen?
I've been waiting for somebody to ask. Yes, the KGB did this quite frequently. I don't know if anybody knows if they ever did it in America, which I think means there's a good chance that maybe they didn't, but they did it with some frequency in Western Europe. KGB illegals married secretaries of influential government officials throughout Western Europe in operations that the Clark-Martha relationship is modeled on. They did it to gain intelligence. They stayed married to the women for many years. The women didn't know at all, started to suspect, knew but didn't know. Whatever you may think of Martha and her state of awareness is, that was, you know, they were probably different, all of these women. Most of these relationships, after many years, the police would find out, they would arrest the men, they would spy trade them or put them in jail. The women would be confronted with the crime that had been committed, and in most of the cases, the women would deny it. They would be presented with all the evidence. They would say it can't be true, or he loved me anyway. So there's a whole crazy, crazy, hard to believe history here that this is based upon.
Regardless of the outcome, they had fantastic sex lives. I've been told.
Well, I was just going to ask a question about research, which maybe I need to rethink now. let's see. I'm going to ask anyway. How much did you prepare by reading about the Cold War, reading about that era in history for spies or just in general?
It's in my blood.
She's not lying.
Well, can you talk a little bit about your history and how you came to America?
I was born in Afghanistan, and I was fortunate to go to live in different countries and amongst different cultures. My dad is Indian and my mom is Russian. He speaks like 8 languages, so I was really blessed. And I've talked to my dad a lot.
He's really excited
about the show. And
yeah. Have your parents seen it?
Proud.
Have your parents seen the show?
Yes.
Do they like it?
Well, my mom's in Germany, so they're not. I think season 2, maybe they'll start. Well, they've watched it. Yeah. My dad is watching it every Wednesday. He's really proud. He approves. Yeah. Right. So
thank God.
Correct. By the way, I'm telling you.
How about you, Margot? Did you read a lot about the period?
I didn't read a lot, but I read. I read spy novels all the time.
Mm. That's funny.
Spy and murder. But I watched some documentary that Matthew told me about. And
called The Cold War.
Helpful.
I didn't watch all of it, but I watched some of it.
Yeah.
And I talk to Joe and Joel a lot. It's true.
And then there was all the Wig research. The Wigs of the 80s.
And I lived through that.
Yes.
Thank God. I lived through the 80s.
Do you remember them?
Not much.
Who does, really? Who wants to remember the 80s? I don't. Bad, bad, bad haircuts. Many bad haircuts. Noah, how about you? Is that something important for you in building a character? Did you want to come at it more?
I think it helps. I'll take anything that helps, you know, so I could have go with the shotgun approach. Just anything that can, you never know how it's going to pay off or inform a choice or your understanding of the context. But so I talked to some FBI guys. I read a couple of books about cooking. I lived through it somewhat. I was a little bit active politically when I was a teenager in the
for Russia
90s. Anything, you know.
Right.
Joe has been a great source of our primary source, I think, of spycraft and the real
deal.
We had a great day with some of us. Joe gave us a lesson in counter-surveillance technique and just the culture and the sense. You know, I actually spent some time at the CIA myself for a different project, but it helped quite a bit for this project.
When you talk to people in the field, did they talk about having families? I mean, is that common? Matthew can address this too, because, you know, a lot of these people, they go home at night, they have families, and they're putting their lives on the line every day. It seems like it's an incredible strain to try to balance the emotional needs of your family and the stress of the jobs. Is that something that you guys have researched or talked to agents about?
There's actually, I should hand over to Joe, because there's that great story you said about operatives in the CIA, that there comes a day in their lives. I'll hand over, actually, about when they tell the children.
Yeah, well, I did when I was at the CIA. That was one of the things that interested me most, was those stresses and what it was like to have a family, and particularly for the officers serving abroad and their wives or husbands and kids were with them. And I was struck by the fact that there was a day, the parents lied to their kids about what they did. They couldn't say to their kids, mom or dad works at the CIA, because the kid would go to school and say, my dad works at the CIA, then you don't work at the CIA anymore.
Yeah.
You know. So, but when the kid reached a certain age, and it wasn't prescribed exactly, it was really 13, 14, 15, whenever you judge that your kid was mature enough to keep a secret, you had what was called the talk. Mm. And that's when you sat your kid down and essentially said...
Not that talk, but the CIA.
The
talk.
Yeah.
You want to talk about what?
You did them both at once. It was very economical. It was quite a day for these kids.
You can also kill a person with a condom.
Those kids are so traumatized.
Exactly. Yeah. Never got over it. But anyway, so whatever, kid is 15 years old, and the parents sit them down and tell them they've been lying to them their entire lives about something very fundamental to their identities. And it was generally very traumatic. You know, for some of these kids and families, it went over okay and didn't screw them up for the rest of their lives. For a pretty high percentage, it was profoundly... destructive and painful. So sort of thinking about a show that could bring that sense of a family dealing with these struggles and what it's like for parents to lie to their kids to TV.
Especially during an era, like when you're an adolescent, you're questioning your parents no matter, like if your dad is an accountant, you still think, yeah,
you're a liar.
You're a liar. You're a hypocrite. Like, you know, at the best of times, people... Yeah. So it seems like that'll be definitely a recurring thing. And, you know, one thing, got to finish off by talking about the Jennings. You know, we saw their relationship go through this kind of sort of valley and then sort of a peak at the end when the bond that we saw reaffirmed in the pilot was actually the whole season led to even an even deeper reaffirmation of that bond. So I would assume... Set me straight if I'm wrong, that you're not going to go to that place of are they in peril and are they going to split up, but it's still the center of the show going forward?
I think at its core, there's a show about identity and about relationships, and about relationships explored through marriage and family.
So she will make it?
It's looking that way.
We still have a couple fine deal points to hammer.
Okay. Ballsy.
So it's not going to be a new wife imported from the Soviet Union every season, like, hi, I'm Susan.
Yeah. I pitched that.
Whoever plays the role, like, we're just going to have them say it's Elizabeth.
It's Elizabeth. It's just replace her every season. It's like, no one.
She's irreplaceable.
Well, just working with Carrie, you know, it seems like from what I've heard from that first read, you know, reading scenes together, that when you had those first meetings, was it really apparent to you that there was, I really think the show would have a much harder road to hoe if they didn't have that chemistry that you have on screen. Is that, did you feel it in the first meeting after she slapped you or before or at no point?
You tend to try and force or try and show people how well you're getting on and how much chemistry there is in the room between you. But I was incredibly lucky, you know, with Carrie that I think, you know, we had a natural rapport and we interact well together, and that's all you hope for at the end of the day. And less scar tissue.
Do we have any more? Can we do? Let's do the two questions, then maybe we'll finish.
Not that it's a competition, but.
So, question.
There's Vidania.
Yes.
I was wondering to the creators about the inception of the show, the concept, how it came about, and also if you can elaborate a little bit on how sort of what your overall objective is in terms of illuminating Americans to this particular era and what they want to take home for people that weren't involved in that era, what you want to sort of pass on as far as the significance of that time period.
I'll do what I like to do, which is answer the easy part of that and let you answer the hard part. The inception of the show was in 2010. Some of you, or maybe all of you, remember that a bunch of KGB, or not KGB, but Russian intelligence service illegals were arrested in the United States, I think 10 of them. They were the modern version of what Philip and Elizabeth were in the 1980s. And shortly after they were arrested, I got a call from the heads of DreamWorks Television who said, would you be interested in trying to develop a TV show based on this? And I thought, I don't know. But that's what I thought, because it seemed like weird, like, why are they even spying on us now? And I just wasn't sure it was a great idea for a TV show. But I said, great, that's a great idea. And I just started wandering around the streets until I realized, oh, if you put it back in the Cold War, then it could be a really good idea for a show. And that's how the whole thing sort of kicked off.
You have to now, answer the hard
part. I have to answer the hard part of the question? Yeah.
Your answer was so good that I forgot the hard part of the question. But in terms of what we hope people to think about looking back on that period, or people who weren't there, Joe and I both lived through that period, and we talk about it a lot. There was a time in history not so long ago where there was this thing called the Cold War. And at that time, it seemed like there were essentially three possibilities. Either the West was going to win, the Soviets were going to win, or we're going to die in some sort of sudden thermonuclear annihilation. And that third option was real, and it hung over us. And the idea of taking these personal dramas and putting it in that context is really exciting to us, and we hope that it'll be, on the one hand, just entertaining and fun, but also an opportunity for people to look at their own lives in a different way.
We have one on this side now.
For Joe and Joel, you had a great episode early in the season where you dealt with Reagan getting shot. Just sort of going forward, I'm sure you have those episodes that you've kind of earmarked in history, but how do you deal with the leeway of giving yourself, kind of showing the KGB response while also sort of respecting history but making it exciting?
It's a great question. We could speak to the Reagan assassination attempt episode specifically. What we decided was that we would stick to the facts in terms of what actually happened, and yet create our secret history as well. That's our dreamed up history.
And our general rule for the dreamed up history is it shouldn't be anything that can be overtly proven to be false. But I'll give you an example. In that, there was that tape that they got from the Caspar Weinberger bug in the Reagan assassination attempt episode. There actually was a tape made in the White House Situation Room that day. Al Haig actually did get a replica, get a copy of the nuclear football brought to him. And the fact, and those responses that we heard on the tape in Caspar Weinberger's, that was, those conversations happened that day. So it's, is it possible that a KGB agent figured out how to listen in on that conversation? Well, these guys are good.
It's all in the wigs.
It is? It's all about the wigs. Is there one last question that we're going to do?
Oh.
Okay, let's take those.
Thank you very much for being here. I'm Cindy Targosh, and I have a question regarding the Clark-Martha relationship. And forgive me, I think I might have missed this part of the episode, or the episode where, what is it that led Martha to believe that she could trust Clark, or was it just good sex with glasses on?
You were there.
How did you do it? That was a stunt double. That was, if you noticed, that guy had a six-pack. I think it's sort of set up. To me, it was set up in the pilot when it's explained to her who Clark is and his relationship, you know, with the sort of Federal Bureau, and I think it's from that day on that he kind of has her. She has that same sort of dutiful obligation to country.
That's what he told her what he did, and she believed it.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. And then from then on in, it was just a simple
I had missed that,
love
I just
story.
Said this key component.
Yes,
thank you.
And great sex in glasses.
I really enjoyed the show. I grew up actually in Berlin. My dad was a U.S. journalist, and he would always tell us stories about how he was being shadowed when he went to the East Bloc. That was his main beat. And we kids were bored. You know, we weren't really interested, but, you know, it just seems real now watching it. I actually used to smuggle motorcycles out of the Soviet East Zone because that was just... We could do it, you know. I was on the U.S. military bus, and that's how we did it. But anyway, do you foresee any episodes where these characters somehow venture over there and do foreign missions?
Well, I think it would. We have talked about various stories that would take them abroad. I think it would be pretty risky for their cover to take them to Eastern Europe or anywhere that close to the Soviet Union. But I could see them going to, you know, Nicaragua or some of the hot spots a little closer to home for them.
Yeah, and also you mentioned your father was a journalist in Berlin during the Cold War and traveled around a lot. When did he tell you that he was actually a CIA operative? And
he still hasn't told
us. And actually, the CIA did approach him while he was studying in Berlin to become a journalist. And I think he did one, he had to carry one package over once and then said, no, yeah, that's
just
not
one, right. That one, yeah. Time.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if it's a story, but it's still
a lie. I'll never do it again.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much to this fabulous cast and executive producers of The American.
Thank you, everybody.
And thanks for the great questions.